was once in a lifetime. They're breaking new ground, making something meaningful. Mining methane hydrate frozen beneath the seabed. There's alternatives, but none so plentiful. It's clean and safe. I couldn't say no.
Sorry about your weekend, but someone had to draw the short straw. We've got a lot of updates to get through, but new suit, same rules. Give me a sec. Okay, instruments. O2. dialed up. Don't want to miss that. I'll circle back with JJ tomorrow. Get this all wrapped up.
February 2nd. We were 50 miles from the epicenter. But an 8 on the Richter scale makes that kind of distance irrelevant. Shockwaves hit 6 minutes later, striking the south face of the HAB first and hardest. 27 minutes in, with that kind of concussive force, even the sealed modules were compromised. After that came the ocean. By 10:33, only safe havens in a sub or one of the suits.
Thank you.
it's all bearing down on so many levels, it's gotta be managed. You can't shake the pressure. Just make your peace with it. Don't let it take the wheel. Protocol for everything. Has to be. Something to fall back on. Second guessing puts lives at risk, so it's best to stick to procedure, step by step. So with an all hands call, you head straight for Compass One. Try and reach surface from comms.
Thank you.
From the outside, the structure seemed intact. So I figured whoever's inside might... Well, maybe it's okay. We ran all kinds of drills. You believe you know what to expect? Once I got inside, where it's familiar and you should feel safe. Even though I had to, those first few steps weren't easy. reaching the surface was off the table, physically or otherwise. So it's simple. Hitch a sub to Compass 2 and hope others did the same. Normally, the habs are lit up top to bottom, all the time. A lot of the gear was waterproof. Some of the lights and monitors were still running. So it wasn't dark, but it's fading. Like the whole thing's on life support. relentless. I mean, the isolation is unnatural. Little problems start to spiral. Any baggage you don't check at the surface comes unpacked pretty quick. Some find ways to cope, others struggle. Watching life go by inside the bubble is cruel. The ones that care get a head start learning to live without you. So the grief comes first, whether or not you're really gone. I've seen death before, but not like this. Up here, the impact's usually more abstract. This is intimate. It's like when you pass an accident on the freeway. All the possibilities run wild. But then a song you like comes on, or your exit's coming up, and you've moved on. Back to normal. They're planning on 60, 75 once the whole thing's staffed up. So with just 20 of us, there's already this hollow quality. Like dropping by the office when everyone's gone for the weekend. Not a lot of time for recreation, but the options were there. They did their best to keep us happy.
Thank you. 5 more minutes. Repeat, we are leaving in... If you're any... And right now is...
Trust, everything else gets triple checked. But so much diligence makes every aspect of daily life heavy. Each task or item, like getting into a suit or going outside, has an equivalent weight. So for getting cargo or yourself over to Compass 2, the shuttle's the most efficient option, relatively speaking. They kept the heat up, but the weight and presence of the ocean, you can't shake that. Gets under your nails and gums like your teeth are coming loose. And then at some point it recedes. You might not notice that till you're topside, but it's always there. Giving up. With that much time to think about nothing. Just about anyone would. Thing is, the suit's designed to keep you safe, even from yourself. Makes it hard to take the easy way out. Still, does it make it better knowing how bad things really are? The suit keeps out what you need to be afraid of. Only the fear is trapped in there with you, and it's thriving. So yeah, maybe you're safe and dry, but inside you're drowning.
But what happened next caught you completely off guard. Can we talk about that?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
I was hoping you'd talk about the moment when you realized that the ones you collided with were, in fact, the ones you were trying to save.
It was horrible. I mean, the odds of us finding them in the first place were poor. I sure as hell didn't expect to run into them. I I don't know. I mean, I never found out who was in the other half of the wreck. Not alive, anyway.
Talking about protocol. By your own admission, there are instances where you didn't follow procedure. There's your radio and Cora. Granted, this was unprecedented. But as you said, second-guessing puts lives at risk. Do you think the outcome might have been better if you'd just followed the rules?
Well, it might, but there's no way to know that.
Thank you.
So you're lost and looking for some way out of all of this. And really, your only option now is the other habitat, Compass 2. And what's most unsettling to me is you're in this dive suit. You call it a walking coffin. I can't even imagine what that takes.
It takes everything. But when you're losing your strength and your senses, well, like I said, it helps you focus on what little's left.
Even setting that aside, so much about your ordeal is almost beyond most people's comprehension. Were you ready for this? Or were you lucky?
No. No luck.
You mentioned possibilities. Does a part of you wonder where you'd be if you'd never gone down there in the first place?
Not really. I mean, that kind of thinking won't get you anywhere. Thank you. The last day of third grade, we drive down to the dock. She points at her watch, tells me, close your eyes. She puts her hand on my chest, says, 10 seconds. And then I'm falling. I'm gonna drown. I mean, I'm sure of it. She's shouting, not to interfere. 10 seconds later, her hand's on mine, pulling me up. The next day we go again, only now it's 15. I'm up all night watching the clock, trying to count 20 on the dot. I knew so long as I, you know, hold out, 40 seconds, 45, she'd come. And one day she didn't. My first thoughts, maybe I messed up the count. My second thoughts, I'm on my own. I open my eyes and the sun's behind her. But I know that shape, it's familiar. Arms crossed, staring down at me. By the time I climb onto the dock, she's already home.
Methane is a greenhouse gas, one of the most potent. Other industrial disasters may have been more severe, but Oceanova was groundbreaking, like you said. It could be years before we know all the consequences. We might never understand the ecological impact. It was very expensive, and 19 people died. Like it or not, you're the human face of all this. So what do you say to your critics?
I believe in what we were doing.
But was it worth the cost? Engineer, you're a problem solver. You value logic and precision. You talk a lot about times, distances, values, and yet there were some challenges you couldn't solve.
Numbers are easy. It's people that are complex. Numbers bring things into focus. No gray areas to distract you from getting things into perspective.
Thank you.
Does it get easier answering all the same questions?
People ask all kinds of questions. What they ask says a lot about their character, especially when it comes to casualties.
So what's the response when they do ask about the gory details?
I oblige. See which way they want to take it. I mean, what people don't get is that they don't want me to keep going. Not really. There's only so much blood and guts people can take before they lose their appetite. Everyone has their limits.
Very candid when describing some circumstances. Times when you felt crippled with fear, coming across the bodies of friends and colleagues.
Yeah.
It's clear you care, but there's an undercurrent of detachment in the way you present some of the more difficult moments. Was that your intention?
No, I've heard that before. I just did my best to paint a clear picture. When it comes to empathy, there's no manual for that.
Thank you.
I have to ask again. Was it luck?
Conditioning. Conditioning and discipline. It's how I got down there in the first place, and that's how I got out. It's about keeping tethered to the task. You don't let yourself forget about the reality around you. You can't.
Thank you.
you saw terrible things. And even if you made it to the surface, you couldn't count on being rescued. I mean, I'd have lost my mind. Did you ever feel like you were losing it, just a little?
No. When they found me, I'd been floating on the surface for at least 5 hours. I talked with therapists and trauma experts for months. Said I was hiding the hurt. But it's not true. I made mistakes down there, yes, but did I lose my mind? No. No way.
Is defined by the fact that you came back alone. Your story started with 20 people, but ends with one. So when it comes to telling those stories, you're the only one who can.
Yeah. There's a responsibility to get things right, for the record.
Welcome back to Open Air. I'm Emily Kaler. If you're just joining us, my guest is Kip Mattis, sole survivor of the Oceanova disaster. His first book, Hell or High Water, is a harrowing account of his ordeal. Earlier, we talked about the life aquatic, escaping the flooded habitat, and being lost on the seafloor inside a half-ton titanium diving suit.
Thank you.
Tip, I know this might not be easy, but I'd like to talk about the end. Can you read that for us?
Yeah. The list is getting shorter. The hatch opens with its usual reluctance, flooding the room with light. The pod is there. I'm going home. Tomorrow, I'll be the sole survivor. But for now, I'm not alone.
How did you feel when you figured it out?
At that point, and that close, I was running on fear. So when I saw another suit in the room, it's almost too much to process. I couldn't believe that it was...
Virgil, is that you?
Virgil made it. Just like me.
How did you get? I thought everyone was...
Only I'm locked inside the pod, and he's locked out.
Can you hear me? I can't stop the launch. There's no override.
He's not coming back.
Oh, God. I'm sorry.
And that's on me.
So are you saying that if you did something differently, that Virgil would have lived?
That's right. Until I saw him, fear in his eyes, I thought I was the only one. It was a bad call.
How can it end like this? Oh God, I'm sorry. No.
Didn't kill him.
Really? Who did? Bad luck? I'm responsible. Look, I'm up here talking with you, and he's still out there.
Thank you.
It's been more than a year since all this happened. You wrote a book and told your story. Are you ready to be done?
Yeah, yeah. It's time to move on. Get myself working again.
Kip Mattis, thank you so much for spending time with me today.
Thanks for having me, Emily.
Thank you.